Hello students, welcome back to online classes. I am Swati madam, your biology teacher from Silver Oak School. As you were aware that you are attending your online classes at home every day, you would need a notebook and pen to attend these classes. Hope you are ready with your notebook. Let us start the class now. Today we are going to discuss about a unit called animal tissues, unit 3 in grade 9. So before you have learnt about plant tissues, the different types of plant tissues and its functions, in this lesson we are going to learn about the animal tissues. So first of all, what is meant by tissue? Tissue is a group of cells with a similar structure and function. As you learned before, what is meant by tissue? Tissues are a group of cells with a similar structure and function. Here in animal tissues, we have different types of tissues and specific functions are involved in this. Before learning about different types of animal tissues, let us first learn the activities which is given in our textbook. Let us see the activities now. Students, before learning the animal tissues, the types of animal tissues and its functions, let us learn about certain activities given in our textbook. The first lab activity given in our textbook is identification of tissue in the collected sample. The apparatus required for this activity are microscope, slide, dilute HCl, forceps, brush. Coming to the procedure, you have to collect a small piece of chicken with bone from your nearby chicken centers or market. For observing each type of tissue, you need to follow specific procedure. After completion of every activity, do not forget to draw the diagram and answer and discuss the questions. Now coming to the procedure, you have to take a small piece of chicken with bone and put it in dilute HCl for 2 hours. Take the skin part of chicken piece. Listen carefully, we have to take the skin part of the chicken piece. As you know very clearly, skin is the protective layer for the chicken. Place the material with forceps or brush onto the slide. Then keep on the another slide on it and press both gently. Observe under the microscope. The same procedure as you learnt in your 8th standard for observing the onion peel cells and human cheek cells. The same procedure should be followed and you have to observe under the microscope. Draw the diagram of what you observe under the microscope in your notebook. Compare your diagram with the following picture. Now let us see the picture here. You can see it very clearly. Now try to find out the answers. I am asking you, are all the cells similar here? I am repeating the questions, children. Are all the cells similar? Yes, it is similar. How are they arranged? They are arranged in a continuous pattern, regular pattern is there without any intercellular spaces. Is it or not? Next question, are these cells tightly packed and formed as continuous sheath? Are these cells tightly packed and formed as continuous sheath? Yes, these are tightly packed. Is there any intercellular space between them like air spaces? No, there are no intercellular spaces between them and it is forming a continuous sheath, tightly packed with each other. Think why these cells look like continuous sheath. Just now I told you skin is a protective layer. It is the outermost protective layer. So it is a continuous sheath spreading all over. Does this tissue covering protect inside and outside of the animal body? Yes. Now coming to the next procedure, lab activity. Procedure 2. Take a sterilized syringe needle. Collect one drop of blood from fingertip by pricking with syringe needle. Take a slide, keep the finger on the slide to collect one drop of blood. Put another slide on it gently and press both slides. Observe under microscope, draw the diagram of what you observe under microscope in your notebook. Compare your diagram with the following picture. The same procedure as you did for the first lab activity. Now let us see the picture and questions. Now try to find out the answer. What you observe here? You know very clearly the blood cells you are studying from your 6th grade. These are all the blood cells. Are all cells in your blood samples are same? Think and say. Are all the cells in your blood samples are same? No, it is not same. Is there any fluid like substance? Yes.
While making a blood slide, sometimes air bubbles also formed. It may confuse you. Do not be hurry to observe. Yes, of course, this will happen while observing the air bubbles. It just resembles the blood cells. So you have to do the procedure very clearly. Do you agree that blood is a tissue? Yes, of course. We are also going to discuss about this blood. It is a connective tissue which we are going to study in this lesson. Coming to the last lab activity, procedure 3. Take a piece of muzzle of chicken. Before, in the first lab activity, we discussed about the skin of chicken, epithelial tissue. Here we are going to discuss about the muzzle of chicken, which is collected for activity 1. Put it in, same procedure should be followed. Put it in dilute HCl or vinegar and leave it for 2 hours. Next morning, collect the piece of muzzle on a slide with forceps. Put another slide on it, press it gently. Observe under the microscope. Now let us answer these questions. See, just observe the picture very carefully and try to find out the answers. How are the cells arranged? Check carefully the diagram. How are the cells arranged? It is just arranged like bundles of fibers. Is it or not? Bundles of fibers, thin fibers, elongated fibers. Do you find any difference between skin cells and muscle cells? I'll show you the skin cells picture now. See here, look here, it is very continuous sheath. It tightly packed with each other with no intercellular spaces. But here in the muscle cells, it is somewhat loosely packed and it is bundle fiber-like structures. If you want to observe the bone tissue in the chicken bone, settle it in vinegar or dilute HCl overnight. It is better to do this one day before your discussion. Then only the bone becomes soft. Take a piece from it by using knife. Do you find any relation among these tissues? Listen carefully. Do you find any relation among these tissues? Through these three lab activities, we have discussed about the skin, blood and muscle. These three come under animal tissues. Is this tissue useful for movements in our body? Yes, you are right.
So students, after learning these activities, we understood that there are different types of animal tissues with specific functions. So there are some animal tissues which will give protection to the animal body. There are some tissues which connects from one place to another place. There are certain tissues which will send some responses or informations from one place to another place. Based on this, animal tissues are classified into 4 different types. How many types? 4 different types. What are they? So there are 4 different types of animal tissues. The first one is epithelial tissues. Note down, children. Epithelial tissues. E-P-I-T-H-E-L-I-A-L. Epithelial tissues. Second one, connective tissues. C-O-N-N-E-C-T-I-V-E. Connective tissues. Third one, muscular tissues. M-U-S-C-U-L-A-R. Muscular tissues. Fourth one, final one, nervous tissue. N-E-R-V-O-U-S. Nervous tissue. So, first of all, we will start learning from the epithelial tissues. How many types of animal tissues are there? 4 types. What are they? Epithelial tissues, connective tissues, muscular tissues and nervous tissue. Let us learn about the epithelial tissue in detail. This epithelial tissue forms the outermost covering of the body. It gives protection. Students, here in the epithelial tissue, epi means outer, thelium means tissue. Note it down. Epi means outer, thelium means tissue. Epithelial tissue. It forms the outermost covering of the body. So what it will do? It forms the outermost covering of the body. It is present in the skin. Skin is the main protective organ of the body. It is present in the skin, lining of the mouth, lining of blood vessels, alveoli, lung alveoli and kidney tubules. Alveoli is an important part in respiratory system of lungs, which you are going to study in your 10th grade. So these are the places where this epithelial tissue is located. Epithelial tissue forms the outermost covering and it permits certain materials to exchange between the body and external environment. So there are different types of epithelial tissues. Let us see and learn the different types of epithelial tissues.
Children, let us study about the types of epithelial tissues. As we discussed before, we have different types of epithelial tissues which give protection to the body. It is the outermost covering. So here, first one, simple squamous epithelium. Simple squamous epithelium diagram I have given here. In the cells lining blood vessels or lung alveoli, where transportation of substances occurs through a selectively permeable surface. As you know, selectively permeable means it will allow movement of few particles. There is a simple, flat, extremely thin kind of epithelium known as simple squamous epithelium. Where it is present? It is present in the lining of the mouth, esophagus. It is present in the digestive tract. It is a part in the digestive tract. Lungs and alveoli. Alveoli, esophagus, you will learn in your 10th grade. Coming to the next epithelial tissue, stratified squamous epithelium. This stratified squamous epithelium you can find clearly here. Squamous epithelium is a general thin delicate one, but here stratified squamous epithelium, it is arranged in many layers to prevent wear and tear mechanism. Since they are arranged in layers, you can observe here it is arranged in the form of layers. The epithelium is called as stratified squamous epithelium. It is mainly present in the skin. Where it is present in our skin, which protects the body. So now let us discuss about cuboidal epithelium. This is cuboidal in shape and forms the lining of kidney tubules and ducts of salivary glands. Here it is cubed in shape. In some cases, a portion of the epithelial tissue folds inwards and form a special type of gland known as glandular epithelium. It performs a function of secretion and absorption. This is cuboidal epithelium seen in the kidney tubules and ducts of salivary glands. Coming to the next epithelial tissue, columnar epithelium. You can see here clearly the columns. Where absorption and secretion occur, as in the inner lining of the intestine, tall epithelial cells are present and are named as columnar epithelium. In the respiratory tract on the outer surface of epithelial cells, there are hair-like projections called cilia. Over this, some cilia, hair-like projections will be present, that is known as ciliated epithelium. When these columnar epithelial tissues have cilia, then they are called ciliated epithelium. They are present in the lining of trachea. Trachea is a part in the respiratory system, kidney tubules, etc. The rhythmic movement of the cilia helps in the, as you know very clearly, the cilia or flagella helps in the movement of material from one direction to another direction. As we discussed before about glandular epithelium, it looks like this. It is also known as compound epithelium, multi-layered cells. All the layers will be arranged one over the other, that is known as granular epithelium.
Epithelium tissue is composed of single layer of flattened cells resting on the basement membrane with a disc-shaped central nucleus and sparse cytoplasm. It is the simplest of the epithelia and allows diffusion and filtration of substances across the squamous epithelium. Squamous epithelium is located at the inner lining of blood vessels, alveoli in lungs, and Bowman's capsule in kidney. Cuboidal epithelium is composed of single layer of cube-shaped cells resting on the basement membrane with large central nucleus. Cuboidal epithelium facilitates secretion and absorption. Therefore, it is commonly found in the ducts of glands, tubular parts of nephrons, and surface of ovary. Columnar epithelium is composed of a single layer of tall and slender cells, resting on basement membrane with spherical nucleus at the base of each cell. Free surface of the columnar cells may have microvilli. Columnar epithelium helps in secretion and absorption. Thus, these tissues are found in inner lining of stomach and and intestine. The columnar and cuboidal epithelium, if bare cilia on their free surface, they are known as ciliated epithelium. Cilia are thread-like protoplasmic projections that help in the movement of particles or substance in a specific direction over the epithelium. Ciliated epithelium is located at the inner lining of the bronchiole and oviducts.
Hope you understood about epithelial tissue. Let us now discuss about the next animal tissue, connective tissues. Connective tissue, the name itself indicates it connects different organs in the body, from organ to muscle, muscle to organ, like this different connections are present. Suppose, imagine if you tilt your body, if you bend or move forward or if you jump, will the organs present in your body will move from one place to another place? No, it doesn't happen. There is no displacement, only because of connective tissues. So there are different types of connective tissues which will be useful for body defense, body repair, and there are certain tissues which transports the materials from one place to another place. So there are different types of connective tissues, each performing different functions. Let us learn about the connective tissues in detail now.
Now let us discuss about different types of connective tissues. So the cells of connective tissues are loosely spaced and embedded in an intercellular matrix. There will be certain space, fluid-filled space known as matrix. They are specialized to connect various body organs. So as we discussed before, there are different types of connective tissues like blood, bones, cartilage, ligaments and tendons. First one, plasma. As you know, the fluid matrix of blood is called as plasma. Plasma is a yellowish liquid like material. It contains three types of blood cells suspended in it. They are red blood cells, white blood cells and blood platelets. So about blood we are going to discuss in detail. The next one, bones. It is a form of connective tissue that forms the framework that supports the body. It is strong, non-flexible tissue. Here, very important thing you have to note down, it is a hard matrix which is composed of calcium and phosphorus compounds. It is made up of calcium phosphate and calcium carbonate. Is it clear? It is made up of calcium phosphate and calcium carbonate. Note down, students. And these are secreted by cells known as osteocytes. We have osteocyte cells here. I have given you picture. Even you have in your textbook. So bone is made up of calcium phosphate and calcium carbonate. It is made secreted by cells known as osteocytes. OSTEOCYTES. These are present in central hollow portion of the bone called bone marrow. Coming to the next connective tissue, cartilage. It is a type of connective tissue which has widely spaced cells. The solid matrix of this tissue is composed of proteins and sugars. And you know, this cartilage is also known as soft bone. It is also known as soft bone. For example, the simple example, just touch your ear lobe and you can feel there is a soft bone over there which is known as cartilage. Cartilage of your ear can be folded, is it or not? Even the tip of the nose, we have this soft bone known as cartilage. Coming to the next connective tissues, ligaments and tendons. Very, very important thing, ligaments and tendons. Ligaments, it connects two bones, means bone-to-bone connection, we call it as ligament. You can see here, bone-to-bone connection, we have ligament. Tendon means a muscle to bone. Bones are connected to muscles with the help of a connective tissue called tendons. Please note down, children. Ligaments means these are the connective tissues present between two bones. Tendons means these are the connective tissues which are present between muscle to bone. Muscle to bone is called tendon, bone to bone, BLB. Bone to bone is called ligament, muscle to bone is called tendon. The next one, areolar tissues and adipose tissues. Areolar tissue, these are found in the skin and muscles around the blood vessels, nerves. It is filled with space inside the organs. We have fibroblast cells here. fibroblast cells are present in the areolar tissue. It is seen in the muscles, blood vessels, even in nerves. Adipose tissue, very important one. It is found between internal organs and below the skin. It stores fat and it acts as an insulator, so that even in cold conditions, our body is able to tolerate the cold climatic conditions because of the adipose tissue. It acts like an insulator. So these are the different kinds of connective tissues.
So we have different types of connective tissues, which we learned now. Here we learned about tendons, ligaments, cartilage, areolar tissue, adipose tissue and different things. Now we are going to discuss about blood in detail. The blood cells, the types of blood cells and how to detect the blood group, which is very important for our questions. The procedure to determine the blood group type. Children, let us now discuss about a story of blood. Blood is a red stream that flows in closed tubes in our body. Our heart pumps the blood, 36,000 liters of blood in the distance of 20,000 kilometers in the time period of 24 hours. Our heart pumps how much liters of blood? 36,000 liters of blood in the distance of 20,000 kilometers in the time period of 24 hours. So this blood is red in color. As you know, you have studied earlier, blood is red in color due to the presence of a protein known as hemoglobin. So if we think this blood is red in color, do you expect all the animals will have red color blood? No. Cockroach has white colored blood and snail has blue colored blood. So this adult human being have about 5 to 6 liters of blood. How many liters of blood? 5 to 6 liters of blood. So this blood consists of 55% of plasma, 1% of platelets, WBC white blood cells and 44% of red blood cells. In 8th class, you have studied about white blood cells and red blood cells, granulocytes, agranulocytes, which we are going to study here. This plasma, it is a fluid which consists of water, ions, waste, proteins, glucose, etc. Let us study in detail about RBCs and WBCs and platelets. Let us now discuss about types of blood cells. As you have studied in your 8th grade, we have 3 different types of blood cells. Red blood cells, white blood cells and blood platelets. So here, red blood cells are also known as erythrocytes. The blood is red in color because of the presence of a protein known as hemoglobin. RBCs are also known as erythrocytes. ERYTHROCYTES. And these red blood cells will be helpful in the exchange of gases, oxygen and carbon dioxide. Now coming to the WBCs, white blood cells. These white blood cells are also known as leukocytes. It fights against infections. These cells you have studied in your 8th grade. Neutrophils, eosinophils and basophils. These are the 3 different types of granulocytes. Monocyte and lymphocyte. These 2 are agranulocytes. So WBC is also known as leukocytes and it is useful for fighting against infections. Now coming to the last type of blood cell, blood platelets. As you know very well, platelets will be useful for clotting the blood. And these blood platelets are also known as thrombocytes. Let us learn in detail about all these 3 types of blood cells.
So let us discuss about red blood cells, RBCs. As I told before, RBCs are also known as erythrocytes. They are disc-shaped cells. Here you can see the disc-shaped cells. And it doesn't contain any nucleus. Inside that, it doesn't contain any nucleus. Disc-shaped cells are present. And this RBCs contain a pigment called hemoglobin. It contains a pigment called hemoglobin, which is made up of iron containing pigment known as heme and a protein known as globin. So that's why it is red in color. RBCs are produced in the spleen and bone marrow, which is very important to note down. RBCs are produced in the spleen and bone marrow and live for about 4 months. The lifespan of this is 100 to 120 days. So when we donate blood to save the life of a person, then the loss of the blood from our body is recovered within a day because red blood cells are made very fast in the bone marrow. Let us repeat. RBCs are also known as erythrocytes. The lifespan of RBC is about 100 to 120 days. It contains a pigment called as hemoglobin. Because of the presence of hemoglobin, blood is red in color. Coming to the next type of cells, white blood cells. These white blood cells are also known as the leukocytes. It doesn't contain any color. It doesn't have hemoglobin, so it is colorless. It is also known as leukocytes. These cells are less in number when compared to red blood cells. There are two types of white blood cells as we discussed before in your 8th class, granulocytes and agranulocytes. There are three types of granulocytes, neutrophils, basophils and eosinophils. What are they? Neutrophils, basophils and eosinophils. These cells attack and destroy the microorganisms that enter the blood. It acts in the defense mechanism. Some white blood cells sacrifice their life to fight against external enemy microorganisms. These dead white blood cells come out of the wound, which we generally call it as pus. So granulocytes are of three types, neutrophils, basophils and eosinophils, and these dead blood, white blood cells come out in the form of pus. There are again two different types of agranulocytes, lymphocytes and monocytes. Lymphocytes secrete antibodies to guard against foreign material that enter into our blood. So these are called as microscopic policemen, which are called as microscopic policemen. Lymphocytes are also known as microscopic policemen because it acts as a protection against foreign material. Monocytes, what these monocytes will do, it is just like amoeba. As you know, as you have learnt about amoeba, it contains a false foot known as pseudopodia. It just resembles an amoeba. These monocytes attack the foreign materials and engulf them. It just engulf it. These foreign materials are destroyed inside these cells. They are called as scavengers. Remember, these are called as scavengers. Coming to the last type, blood platelets. These are also known as thrombocytes. These are tiny, circular, oval, colorless cells formed in the bone marrow. They doesn't have a nucleus and help in the clotting of blood in a cut or wound, due to which bleeding stops. So these blood platelets will be helpful for the blood clotting, and it is also made in the bone marrow from the cells called stem cells. You might have heard about the stem cells.
Karl Landsteiner discovered blood groups and he was awarded Nobel Prize.
Let us now discuss about the identification of blood group. So the apparatus required here are blood identification kit. The kit is provided here. Glass slide, wax pencil, disposal needle, cotton, alcohol and toothpicks. Let us see the procedure now. So take one porcelain plate, clean and dry it. The plate must be very clean so that it doesn't interfere with the reaction. With a wax pencil, draw three circles on the plate as shown here. You have to draw three circles on the plate. Later, place one drop of corresponding anti-serum. Anti-serum bottles will be provided in the kit. We have to place that anti-serum here on the glass slide. Coming to the next step, choose a finger, clean this fingertip with an alcohol in a cotton ball. Let it dry. Keep the cotton ball nearby as it is needed again. Dangle the hand down to increase the amount of blood in the fingers. Press on to the bottom of the fingertip with the thumb of the same hand. You have to press it so that a drop of blood will come out. Quickly let one drop of blood onto the glass slide, onto the each circle shown here. Do not touch the anti-serum. You should not touch the anti-serum. Remember to properly dispose the used needle. So you have to take a toothpick, mix the blood and anti-serum and stir gently. Use different toothpicks for three different circles. Do not use the same toothpick. Watch to see if any of the samples show agglutination. What is meant by agglutination means you can see some grainy clumps of red blood cells. As you can see here very clearly, there is agglutination in B and D sample. About D we will discuss now. And here you can see, give the inference like this. Suppose if there is agglutination in anti-serum A but not in anti-serum B, then it is A blood group. If you see agglutination in anti-serum B but not in A, then it is B blood group. If you see agglutination, clumping in both anti-serum A and anti-serum B, then it is AB blood group. And if there is no clumping or agglutination in both anti-serum A and B, then it is O blood group. AB is called universal recipient, O is called universal donor. So here, you might have heard the terms that your blood group belongs to O positive, O negative. So these are the two terms, positive and negative terms. It can be determined with Rh antigen, which we are going to discuss now. Rh factor. So here we can see about the Rh factor. Actually, the Rh factor came from the rhesus monkey, RHESUS. It's a blood antigen discovered in 1940 by scientists Landsteiner and Zener, and played an important role during blood transfusion. It is an agglutinogen found in the RBC of most people, called Rh positive. Generally, we will say O positive, O negative. So this positive is nothing but Rh factor. It is also known as a D antigen. Remember, children, it is also known as a D antigen. This Rh factor is also known as the D antigen. It was initially found in the rhesus monkey and later in man. So people who doesn't have this antigen in their blood cells are called Rh negative. See, I have given one example here. You can identify the blood group very clearly. Here antiserum A, antiserum B and antigen D is there. It doesn't show any agglutination in A, but it is showing its agglutination in B and D. So it is very clear the blood group belongs to B positive.
Let us recall the things what we have learned today. We have discussed about animal tissues, what is meant by tissue, different types of animal tissues. There are four different types of animal tissues: epithelial tissues, connective tissues, muscular tissues and nervous tissue. So here we discussed in detail about epithelial tissue, which is the outermost protecting cover of the body. Second one, connective tissue, which connects different organs present inside the body, the internal organs present inside the body. So here in the connective tissue, we have discussed that blood is also a type of connective tissue, and we discussed about the procedure to determine the type of blood group. So children, hope you understood about epithelial tissues and connective tissues, which we discussed today. In the next class, we will discuss about muscular tissues and nervous tissues. So note down all the points and go through all the points, read again. All the best.